This video was brought to you by GeneralPack.com, making power systems intuitive, open, and free to everyone, everywhere. Consider subscribing and supporting through patreon.com/GeneralPack. This is the mechanism for you to support us financially so we can continue making high-quality power system video tutorials. Our corporate sponsor for this topic is AllumiaX.com from Seattle, Washington. Contact them for industrial and commercial power system studies.
Introduction to Power Factor Part 3b. In the previous part, we discussed some of the reasons behind the low magnitude of power factor. In this part, we will look at some of the equipment and techniques which we can employ to improve the power factor. We already know that induction load decreases the power factor by consuming reactive power from the system. But what if we were to insert something in the power system which could act as a secondary source of reactive power? This course of action would cancel out the reactive power needs of the induction loads. The phase angle between the apparent and active power will decrease, which could improve the overall power factor. Power factor correction equipment includes capacitors, synchronous condensers, and AC exciters. Keep in mind that the reactive power required by the inductive load is lagging in nature, whereas the reactive power supplied by the correction equipment is leading in nature. First up, we have the static capacitor, which are the simplest form of power factor correction still in use today. This method consists of inserting a capacitor bank in parallel with the incoming terminals of the inductive load. Once inserted, the reactive power by the inductive load is supplied by the capacitor bank, which neutralizes the effect and improves the power factor magnitude. This is because the reactive power required by the inductive loads act at a positive 90 degrees angle to the real power, and the capacitor act as a negative 90 degrees angle to the real power. Therefore, they cancel each other out, reducing the phase angle. We will be solving a practical example in the next part where we calculate the parameters of the power factor correction capacitors. For now, let's focus on the other two methods of power factor correction. The next one is called a synchronous condenser. We already know from the previous parts that motors have lagging power factor and they consume reactive power. But what if we were to provide an additional magnetic flux than necessary? In addition to that, we remove any loads attached to its shaft. The additional magnetic flux would then cause the motor to start supplying reactive power instead of consuming it as the case originally. The synchronous motors start to behave like a capacitor and it draws the reactive current from the system, thereby improving the overall power factor. Now, a third way to improve the power factor is to use a phase advancer. Since inductive loads, like the induction motor, operate by drawing reactive current from the system, what if we were to provide it with another source to provide the required reactive current? This is where phase advancers come into play. It provides a reactive excitation current for the motors, which relieve the system of any reactive power factor requirement and thus improving the power factor. To summarize it all, there are multiple ways to achieve power factor correction, and it is generally recommended to keep the power factor above 0.8 in order to lower utility costs, minimize the system losses, and improve the overall system efficiency. In part 4, we will solve practical example using mathematical calculations employing the capacitor bank correction technique. We hope you have a continued interest in this topic and series as a student or professional, and we also hope that you find this content useful and enlightening. Please consider subscribing to GeneralPack.com and becoming our patron at patreon.com/GeneralPack.